And we are at our last session before lunch. So we have two interesting talks here. And in fact, you may have noticed that we have two different tracks on our workshop. So in fact, these two talks will be from the game theory and queuing track, which is, I think, the most interesting part of our workshop, because really, there is a point of interaction between game theory and between queuing, and we are trying to search some ways to combine our forces, to attack some models in such a way that to get some profit from both approaches. So I cordially welcome Natalia and then Ilya to deliver their talks, because they will have to travel the next day to some other conference, but by this reason we shifted this to talks from other track. But nevertheless, I think that this would be a very interesting experience for us. So please welcome.
Dear colleagues, I would like to present a talk about one application of game theory to task scheduling in a system called the desktop grid. First, I will introduce the systems called desktop grids. Secondly, I will describe the problem of virtual scaling, which can be solved using desktop grids. And finally, I will present a game-based task scheduling model, which can be used to optimize virtual scaling in a desktop grid. Desktop grid is a computational system which unites geographically distributed computational resources. They can be personal computers, mobile devices, and even game consoles, and so on. They are connected by a local area network or by the internet. Due to the principle of their construction, desktop grids have some advantages. And the main one is a high potential peak performance. There are 2 billion personal computers and about 4 billion smartphones in the world today. So the potential power of such systems exceeds any possible supercomputer. They are highly scalable, so we can add new computing nodes, and the power of this grid increases almost minimally. They are easy in installation and configuration. They have low cost, because we use already existing computer resources. And also software development or adaptation is also easy. But also they have some disadvantages. They are suitable only for the application, for the applications of the type double task. Separate nodes have relatively low performance. The nodes are very heterogeneous by hardware and software. And also, we don't know the availability of the nodes in advance, and the reliability of the nodes is also relatively low. So, such systems require development of special methods for their management and task scheduling. In scientific research, desktop grids are very efficient for solving such applications that can be divided into many independent resource-demanding subtasks. Some examples are Monte Carlo simulations, parameter sweep applications, brute force search, and so on. Today, the software called Boeing is a de facto standard for organizing desktop grids. They can be of two main types. The first one is volunteer computing systems, which base on voluntary programmatic resources. And the second one is enterprise desktop grids, which work within a local network of some organizations that work together on shared computational problems. Let me introduce the applied problem of virtual screening. It is related to drug development. In general, drug development is a very time-consuming and resource-demanding process. With many iterations between so-called dry lab and wet lab, the whole process takes about up to 10-15 years to develop a new drug, and it costs about $1 million. So, in order to make it more cheap and more quick, drug development can be assisted by a couple, performance computing and high throughput computing at early stages. The aim of drug development is discovery of small molecule called HIP, which can bind to a target protein related to the disease and stop the disease progression. An important process is molecular docking. It is a computer modeling of interaction between three-dimensional models of a large protein molecule and a small ligand molecule, which can bind to the protein. The interaction is calculated using special mathematical methods. And the important result is the set of keys or the ligands that show the best ability to bind to the target. The total chemical space of all potential drugs is very large. It is estimated as 10 to the power of 60 molecules. Of course, in practice, people use prepared databases. For example, one of the modern databases is GDB-17, which is, however, also large, containing about 166 billion molecules. For testing in laboratory, we should make a transition from this huge size to only tens of thousand molecules. Such transition is made by replicating chemical space, leaving only important representative compounds for testing. And one of the efficient ways to perform this transition is virtual screening. It is a computational procedure that performs molecular docking and allows to select the set of hits with best binding affinities. The result is the ranked set of hits, and it is important that they are very different, they are quite different by chemical properties, for example, by their chemical shape. So the problem that we try to approach is that the chemical libraries have very large size, and the computational procedures are very expensive for such sizes. And prepared libraries can be inefficient because the chemical diversity may be limited, especially when we study new or rare diseases. So the problem that we state is how to perform virtual screening so as to provide high diversity of results in limited time and provide first useful results as soon as possible so that they can be transmitted to the laboratory. So for to solve this problem, we try to propose the following mathematical models. We use the fact that molecules are different by different chemical properties. We chart the chemical space, for example, by several chemical properties, and divide it into blocks of molecules, such as shown in the picture. We will assign to each block of molecules some priority for such polygons. We will base on some a priori considerations, for example, that molecules of very simple shape are less likely to become drugs, or molecules of very complex shape are also less likely to become drugs, that the molecules highly similar to a known ligand are more likely to become drugs. So, when we perform virtual screening in different blocks at the same time, we can select representative hits from each block and obtain the diverse set of results. So by exploring different blocks, we obtain chemically diverse results. And while we try to explore respective blocks first, there is a better chance to get successful results in short time. In the mathematical model, we base on game theory. We assume that the computational nodes are the players, C1 and so on, C1. We divide the set of computational tasks into disjoint subsets, T1, T2, and so on, Tn, and estimate the fraction of hits or useful results in each block as P1, P2, and so on, Pn. The normalized expected fractions provide us with the priorities of the blocks, sigma j. We also, the complete systems are very heterogeneous. So we also write down the performance of each computational node, which is ops I. And we denote the complexity of computational tasks. packaging. We consider fixed time intervals by length tau. And we assume that each player chooses a block where he wants to search for hits. So the number of players that have chosen the block TJ is NJ. We assume that the more players explore one block, the less valuable is their role, because they get somewhat redundant results. So we denote as delta, depending on NJ, the congestion coefficient of the block. We can write down the utility of the node CI who chooses the block TJ as the amount of useful work he performs when selecting that block. It depends on the congestion coefficient, on the block priority, and on the performance of the computer node and the computational complexity of the task. So when all players make their decision, we get a strategy profile or a schedule. It is the letter S, each component of which is a number of the blocks selected by the player. So we come to the concept of mesh equilibrium. It is the strategy profile or a schedule where no player benefits from changing his strategy unilaterally, or if no other player changes the choice. So no computational node desires to change his block of tasks, but also there is a question, does mesh equilibrium exist in our game? Such games, Gamma, are called congestion games. They have been studied in the literature, and it has been shown that they always possess mesh equilibrium in their strategies. Moreover, rest and better response dynamics converge to the mesh equilibrium in the polynomial time. Heterogeneity of the players and the blocks complicates the model, but due to the form of utility function, also a mesh equilibrium exists. So in the mesh equilibrium, each player aims to maximize his personal utility. But for the laboratory, it is also important to note the social utility, which is an importance, or such kind of a measure of importance of the results for the laboratory and the drug development process in general. Let us denote as gamma the fraction of non-empty blocks chosen by at least someone. Then HB is the expected number of hits that we expect to find in block TB. And then we can write down the total expected number of hits in one iteration. So we propose the following mathematical equation for the social utility. You can see that it tries to reflect the total expected number of hits and the diversity of hits, or the coverage of our blocks. For numerical experiments, we use a relatively small database which contains about 320,000 molecules. They have various chemical properties, and we will use the total number of atoms, the total surface area, and partition coefficient. These charts illustrate that the molecules are diverse by their characteristics. For virtual screening, for simulation of virtual screening, we will set some threshold, which is shown in the chart, and about 1% of molecules fall above this threshold. And in practice, it approximately corresponds to the Ilya threshold for virtual screening in drug development. We divide our database into 16 blocks. We chart it by the number of atoms by x-axis and the polar surface area by y-axis. So you can see that the number of molecules that fall in each block differs, and the number of hits is also different. For example, there are some blocks with very large molecules that will not have any hits at all. special experiments we use the parameters that are summarized in the table. The first experiment was performed with the supergrid model with identical nodes and identical tasks. We try to compare three task scheduling strategies. The first one is game-theoretic, based on the proposed model. The second one is probabilistic strategy, when each node chooses block with the probability equal to its probability, sigma I. The first strategy is minimum. As many different blocks as possible are accessed in parallel. This chart illustrates our experiment with three strategies. The blue one is uniform scheduling. The first chart depicts the fraction of discovered hits on each step of iterations. So the uniform scheduling performs W at all steps in most of the time. Because as we have seen, the variables have very various characteristics in different blocks. The probabilistic scheduling on average performs better, but due to indeterminations, it can perform very badly, which is shown as the whiskers. Or it can perform unexpectedly good in some cases. But the game scheduling is shown in green points, and you can see that at the first stages it outperforms the strategies on average, and which is deterministic, so that it doesn't have much more behavior. Well, for the social utility, we also built the chart, and we can see that game scheduling and probabilistic scheduling are almost the same on average, but probabilistic scheduling again can have very bad performance, and starting from the second half of the computations, uniform scheduling should be ignored. The second experiment responds to a real situation where the subgroup has heterogeneous nodes and heterogeneous tasks. So the parameters are also summarized in table. And here we can see that game scheduling allows to achieve much better results. It outperforms the probabilistic scheduling, and it approximately equals to the best case of probabilistic scheduling. So at least at the first thought, or even first half of computations, the game scheduling performs better, and it should be employed in your task scheduling. As for the social utility, it again performs well. The situation with probabilistic scheduling shows that game scheduling can also be improved, but still on average it performs better than probabilistic scheduling. And here we try to evaluate our proposed social utility function, which is shown here. We try to evaluate its biological meaning. We compute about 1,500 schedules, not exactly not necessarily Nash equilibrium, but just schedules. We calculated the average chemical similarity of hits, which can be from 0 to 1, and we calculated the fraction of discovered hits, the average fraction of on each computation step. And we color the points by their social utility value. So the zero is the most value, and in this case, the most given value corresponds to the maximum value. So we want to show that the closer the points are to the left upper corner of the chart, the better is the social utility. So we can see that, in fact, yes, the greenest points are concentrated closer to the upper point. Also, we introduced modification of the model where the behavior of the player depends on the coefficient value alpha. We multiply the congestion coefficient by alpha and the and wait till the dog bite one on the cipher. And so the coefficient alpha expresses the type of the pair, where the zero coefficient corresponds to the pure and dependent behavior, who only digs in already explored area. And the one is one corresponds to a pure explorer behavior, who aims to explore as many new information as possible. And we suggest that we can adjust the coefficient alpha so as to get the desired behavior of system in the code. And in the next slide, we also perform computational experiments, and as it was expected, adjustment of parameter alpha from 0 to 1 allows a balance between the desired number of keys and the coverage of the search space. So, if we need the better average range of keys covering, we can make the coefficient smaller for all pairs. Or, on the contrary, if we want to explore, we should make the coefficient bigger. So, to summarize, we propose a mathematical model based on the guessing game, and the computational nodes acting as pairs, and the blocks of tasks acting as shared computational resources. We propose a mathematical measure of social utility, and we show that at early stages, our proposed game-theoretic algorithm outperforms the probabilistic one and the uniform one by the rate of this discovery and by the social utility measure. And also we propose the player's step coefficient alpha to balance between the rate of his discovery and search space coverage. So, thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much. So maybe one question? One question? Then I can do a go on just, or maybe a question. So it seems that like social utility includes this maximum and minimum functions, like this maximum of h some sub-index and minimum, but it would be hardly analytically tractable, right?
Yes.
So by this reason, maybe this is the cause that why the probabilistic time to time it outperforms the game scheduling. Maybe if you choose some other utility function which keeps this property, maybe some square root of some square of like differences, whatever, I don't know. Maybe in this case, maybe your scheduling will be even better than, I don't know, just maybe. So we switch to the next speaker. Please thank you, Natalia. And we try to go a bit shorter. Okay. Just, let me switch the slides. Okay. Some problem, no? There is some problem. It is too wide. Okay. Will it fit? No, no, it doesn't. Sorry. Yeah. Let me see what I can.
As a client server architecture, and one computer which tasks and collects the answers. That. Point is one of the popular systems to organize such things. And they can be either local to an organization. Imagine that we join our computers or our institution together, as we did. And also we can create worldwide volunteer projects to solve some really huge problems. For instance, there are quite a few quite famous projects. Take at home was the pioneer, and the extension is developed also in Petrovsk. And they are aiming at very different problems, taking new drugs and studying the universe, very difficult mathematical problems, and so on, so far. And the drawbacks of such systems, among the drawbacks of such systems, are demolition sections or sabotage. And then when you welcome everybody on the globe, there can be other guys, please. So, in the book, Programming Girl, one of my favorites, one of the best books ever written. And it says that the internet, only actively bad guys are not potentially bad guys. And so saboteurs can be organized or individual, they can seek for profit or just having fun. They can be clever or very mechanical. But anyway, we need to have some protection. Some countermeasures. An obvious remedy is to double check the answers. So you sacrifice some performance, do double work, but you can compare the answers and maybe reveal the bad guys. However, saboteurs can include many, not only one, but many computers trying to fool you. And this is quite similar to 15+1 attack in cryptocurrency. How cryptocurrency works? They are supported by continuous solving problems, special cryptographic problems. And if some bad guy have more than one half of power, he can easily fall to the whole system. So next, please. So we can use the game theory for a few purposes. So first, we can test our intuition and maybe discover something unusual and unexpected. And we can use it to create some policies, useful policies. And even we can use game theory methods to create self-adjusting policies. Because if you just create some policy, do this, do this, and do this, you need to change it when the environment changes. And in volunteer computing, it is very changeable. People come, people leave, you know. And game theory can adjust itself in digitalized way. Just because under well chosen rules of the game, all players act in the way you want. And that's the tricky thing is to create correct rules. So we can see the host who is organizing the project and the saboteur has two players in the game. And they are opponents. Their interests are not coincide. The first chooses the replication level, so how many computers double check each task, sacrificing performance for safety. And the other player chooses intrusion, how many computers join the project to do some touch. All computers have some reputation, which depends on the amount of work done. And if the answer is accepted, reputation increases. But if the answer turns out to be wrong, the reputation becomes zero again. So high reputation means much work done for the project, collaborating with the project. Here, the actor does not actually play. We just consider the game theoretical model to understand things and to test our intuition to see what happens. some of them are bad, some of them are good. Don't get tasks over and return answers back. Answers can be wrong. And this, at least two answers are different. We suspect sabotage and renew all nodes that give. Lying nodes lose the reputation. And we assume that all reputation is the same. We take a subset of the nodes with the same reputation. So, if fooled, the server suffers some loss. So, if we take virtual spinning as an example, so if we believe that this substance is promising, and it turns out to be a lie, so we suffer some loss, reputation, whatever, money, so some kind of penalty or threat. And saboteur intrudes the nodes, and he does good work for the project and spends some resources. But fooling the server, he gains some profit. Maybe money, maybe joy, maybe something else. So there is a balance between how much are we ready to sacrifice and what are we expecting to gain. So while gaining the reputation, the bad news on the good work, which is the point. So we have the game situation. Usually in game theory, only the extreme options are used. It's not a theorem, but it's quite often. Either you use all the troops for a battle or you surrender. It's usually not clever to use one half. So it depends, but often it's like that. So we assume that it is like that, so we consider only the extreme options. Either we check everything, use all our computers to check, or just trust. Two options. And the saboteur either intrudes as many computers as he can, or just nothing. It's obvious that there is no pure strategies, because if you know what the other player is planning to do, you can easily beat him. So the game is solved in mixed strategies, and we can see the two play problems. In one, answers are of equal value. So we just solve tasks and get values, 1, 2, 3. All of them are of equal value. And in the second, there are rare values that are already valuable, and all other that are not. You can see this substance good, probably not. But if it is good, it's very interesting. So we have N honest computers and N bad computers. The root, the host doesn't know these values. He knows only this sum, ampersand. And he chooses this new, which is the replication. If all answers coincide, then it is accepted, deleted. There are M bad computers and M middle M of them are lying. Prefer to lie. And if the answer is wrong, some penalty is added to the spent time. Because if we replicate 3 times, we use 3 computers to do the same job, so we spend 3 units of cost of time. So, and the average cost of the host looks like this. This is quite simple. He just spends some computing power. In the case of being fooled, he suffers some penalty. And in case he managed to reveal the liars, all job done by them to improve their reputation remains. So this is the probability that somebody lied but was revealed. Something like that. S is the work done to function as n job.
Sorry, when being revealed, the reputation drops down to zero, no?
But they have done some work, yes. Each of them did some work, yes. And this work they may be. On the other hand, the saboteur gains some profit G if he managed to fall in the system. So he's. Sorry, this mistake, not cost, but his
profit.
Profit, yeah. Profit like this. If he managed to fall the system, he gets G, and if he was revealed, the same. He worked hard, but this, in fact, he collaborated with the project. And I is just some exchange coefficient, because cost units for one is not the same as for that. So here is the matrix of the game. So we have two strategies for each player. Lie as much as you can, don't lie at all, and trust or check as hard as you can. Here are the optimal cost and profit for each player. And we have some threshold for reputation. If reputation is low, then we just surrender. For me, it's quite counterintuition, because if reputation is low, you would check harder. But here it's not the case. If the reputation is very low, you either do not use them at all, or you just suffer the penalty and no use to check. Next, please. And the solution looks as follows. The saboteur gains zero on the average. And the servant, the organizer, have this cost, which is greater than one, asymptotically one. And one is safe situation, when there are no bad guys at all, or when there is no penalty, zero penalty, or when the reputation is very high, which is again no less. But it is more than one. What is interesting here is that the server strategy and his cost depends only on what he knows. It depends on the total size of the grid. He need not to know the exact value of M. It does not depend on anything else. Only on the information the server possesses. And also, it's interesting that all quantities depend on the specific values. Not the penalty, but the penalty per computer. Not the profit, but the profit per computer. So if you have a large, really large unit, it can be quite low. Here is a numerical example. We choose 10 computers, 20 computers, 10 of them are good, 10 of them are bad, some values for energy and so on. The reputation needs to be more than 1.5, and then it will be 2. So each node needs to solve two tasks that are accepted, and then he is allowed to go. So we check only 3% of the task carefully. So it's quite similar to the case of social service. We need to survey only about 2%, 1% of the population of the country to know very precisely their opinion. And the saboteur is 24% rally. He needs to work with you to get this reputation of 2. And the service cost is a little bit less than 5. If you check all tasks, it is much more. And if you don't check it, it's also more. And for higher penalty, even the knowledge about the intrusion, knowledge of M, doesn't help. It's still better to use game theory. So, next please. There are assets of different value.
Quite rightly, it is used to do the code. You just need to change values.
Because you just ignore the unexisting values, and the value of f, g, and everything is changed, but the conclusions remain the same. Game theory can help to develop flexible and powerful methods. What is interesting is that Sabatier's profit can be eliminated on the average. If you get zero, or maybe if you just prefer not to attack. Optimal costs depend only on the information you know. Strategies depend on specific values for one computer, either good or bad. It's very well known that computation is a very powerful thing for killing problems.
Thank you so much. So maybe may I kindly ask you to shift the Q&A session to the lunch? Anyway, thank the speaker again. And so let us shift the next session in 20 minutes further. So let's start at 2:20. Yeah?